Father, we come before you, Lord, and we thank you. Thank you for the opportunity, Lord. Thank you for the privilege. Thank you for the honor that we have to be here, Lord. We don't take it lightly that we get to come and freely worship, Lord. We acknowledge that there are people around the world that are dying just to read pages of the Bible, Lord, to profess the name of Jesus Christ. And yet here we are in our comforts of air-conditioned room and technology and lights and video and sound and all the great comforts that we have, and Lord. So we don't want to take that for granted, Lord. We don't want to think of that and think of anything else, but Lord, think of the fact that we get to come into this place and be honored because of you. So Lord, we acknowledge that it's not a man, it's not a woman that we've come to hear from, it's not the old, it's not the young. Lord, we acknowledge today that it's Jesus that's the leader of this church. And it's in the name of Jesus that we ask your Holy Spirit would speak to us, would lead us and direct us. Lord, I pray as we open up the Word of God, Lord, I pray that it would be my will, it would be my words. Lord, I pray that it would be your will, your words, Lord, that speak to us, that we would come with open ears, open heart, open eyes to see, to hear, to understand your Word. Lord, as we walk out of this place, Father, we would walk out equipped. Lord, we would walk out equipped and blessed by your Word. And Lord, we give you the praise and we give you the honor in Jesus' mighty name. Lord, I ask for your grace. Lord, I ask for your direction. Lord, I ask for your words tonight in this word, Lord, that would speak to each and every one of us where we're at today. We give you the praise and the glory in Jesus' mighty name. We all said?
Amen.
Amen. If you've got your Bibles, go with me to Romans chapter 13. Romans chapter 13. I've been studying on this, been thinking on this. And I wanted to share tonight just a little thought. I don't have a lot. I don't want to overload. On Sunday mornings, we have been just dumping the information of what God wants to do in your life. And so I thought, I just thought we'd take a little midweek recharge and just share a little bit of thoughts. And I thought I'd just share with what God's been working on my heart and what God's been dealing with some things in my heart and in my life tonight about this. And so I titled it Snoozing. 15 years ago, I moved to Oklahoma to go to Rhema Bible Training Center. Now, there are people in this world that are night people, and there are people in this world that are morning people, right? And then there are like the rest of us that are like midday people, right? Or some of you are like, Pastor, like I'm a nobody person. Like I'm not a night person. I'm not an evening or a morning person. I'm just kind of like tired in the morning, tired at night, tired in the middle of the day. I don't even know. Well, I remember when I moved away to college. I moved away with Pastor Joe, our youth pastor. He's over there teaching right now in our youth ministry, and a good friend of mine. We all three young college guys. We got this room together, in this old home made in the '60s. It was this duplex, and the walls were just like paper thin. And one thing that was always kind of funny is that I've always had a hard time in the mornings getting up. And for me, I've just always kind of been immune to that snooze button. You know what I mean? Like the alarm goes off and it's just like snooze. And the alarm goes off, 9 minutes later, right? And it's like snooze. And then the alarm goes off 9 minutes later and it's just snooze. And my alarm, my process of waking up every morning in college was that my alarm would go off for approximately 2 hours. And then finally my real alarm would go off, and that would be my roommate, Pastor Joe, banging on the wall or coming in and unplugging my alarm clock and pulling my blanket off like, get up! And I tell you, it's just something about it. As a matter of fact, I took a picture of my alarms. This is literally, no joke, my alarm clock on my phone. It starts at 3 in the morning, snooze all the way to 7:30 in the morning. It's just there's something about that snooze button. It's just like you can buy a little bit more time, right? The bed, it's cozy, it's cold out, it's still dark out. I don't want to face the day with what's going on. My pillow is so comfortable. I got one of those memory foam pillows, and it just conforms to my face, and it's like all the pillow lines are perfectly lined up with my face line. It's just beautiful. And then there's that snooze button. And I tell you, I think the snooze button is like one of the most dangerous inventions somebody's ever invented. Why? Because there are probably more people that have gotten in trouble around the world because of that doggone snooze button than anything else. Why? Because you've all done that before. You've shown up to work late. Heaven forbid you show up to a Sunday morning service late. You show up to school late. Why? Because that snooze button lets you buy a little bit more time. And even though I'm talking about my own personal sleeping habits, we as humans, we as people, we especially in our cultures today, we have this kind of tendency to hit the snooze button on life. To kind of want to say, I want to buy a little bit more time. I just want to stay where I'm at right now. To hit the snooze button on that relationship that needs something. To hit that snooze button with your kids, to hit that snooze button in your job, to hit that snooze button in your finances. How about this? How about this? God's got a call for your life and God's got a purpose for your life, and you've been feeling God speaking to you saying, you know what? It's time for you to step out of your comfort zone. And we as Christians, we as people, we as humans have this tendency to kind of want to just hit that snooze button and kind of sleep in a little bit, to kind of delay it, to kind of just stay where we're at. Why? Because the bed is comfortable. The area of our life is comfortable. You know what? To try to repair my marriage, you know, that's going to take a lot of work. And I'm just not sure I'm ready to do that. I'll hit the snooze button and wait till tomorrow. To step out in faith and talk to somebody about my faith in Jesus Christ. You know, that takes me out of my comfort zone. That's like taking the comforter off on a cold morning. I'm not ready for that. I'm going to hit the snooze button until the next week. To step out in faith and start trusting in God for my finances, or to start sowing into my children's life beyond what I know I need to do. I look every day and I think, man, that was a wasted opportunity. You know what? Tomorrow I'm going to do it. And then tomorrow rolls around and you're tired. You're exhausted from the job. You're emotionally drained. And then you got to come home and try to raise kids. And you say, you know what? I'm going to hit the snooze button and I'll just get it later. The snooze button is that very thing that delays the progress, delays the process, delays what's ahead of us. And our society, our culture, our nature is, we kind of want to push those things that take us out of the comfort zone, that take us out of the place that God wants us to be. We have a tendency to want to push those things off until we really can't wait anymore. But you know, God didn't design you. God didn't create you. God didn't give you what you have in life so that you could snooze your way through life. You know, there's a whole sort of lingo that people say, like, I don't want to sleepwalk through the process of my life. But you know, there's a lot of people that are sleepwalking through their marriages. There's a lot of people that are sleepwalking through their Christianity. There's a lot of people that are sleepwalking, letting somebody else raise their kids, the television or the culture or the teacher at school. And we're hitting the snooze button saying, I'm not ready to get up. I'm not ready to do this. I'm not ready to do that. But God says, I didn't create you to sleepwalk through life. I didn't create you to hit the snooze button and buy yourself a little bit more time. God said, I created you to do something with your life, to see the value in that. Today, I thought I'd take you to a section of scripture that is challenging to us. It's an admonishment to the church. Paul is really nailing the church. He says, listen, man, it's time. He says, stop doing it how you used to do it. Stop sleepwalking through life. Stop hitting the snooze button. And look what Paul says in Romans, the 13th chapter. Paul says it like this. He says, and do this, knowing the time. Man, that's really important, knowing the time. We're going to talk about that. That it is high time to awake out of sleep. For now, our salvation, for now, right here, right now, today, you don't know what tomorrow brings. He says, right now, here, today, our salvation, our end game, the final result of our life, it's nearer today than it's ever been before. He says, the night is far spent, the day is at hand. Let us cast off the works of darkness. Let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk properly as in the day, and not in revelry and drunkenness and lewdness and lust, and not in strife and envy. But put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lusts. Paul says, look, you've been sleepwalking enough. You've been hitting the snooze button in your life for long enough. He says, you got to know the time right now, today, in the middle of Wednesday evening, right here at church. Paul is telling you, the Word of God through the Spirit of God is telling you, listen, it's high time in your life to stop hitting the snooze button on what God wants to do in your life, and to wake up out of the slumber and put on the position and the person of Jesus Christ in your life, and to be and to grab and to get a hold of what life God has for you. Jesus said, I have come that you would have life, right? And that you would have it more abundantly. He said, I didn't say I would come to give you life that you could sleep in. But yet, that takes us out of our comfort zone. I was thinking about this and I thought, you know, what are the things that cause us to sleep in? What are the things, now I'm not talking about sleeping in, like, what are the things that cause us to sleep in? Well, staying up late causes you to sleep in. Now, I'm not talking about physical sleep. I'm talking about our spiritual life. I'm talking about our heart. I'm talking about our soul. I'm talking about our emotions. I'm talking about our desires and our will. What are the things that cause us to hit the snooze button on these emotions? What are the things that cause us to hit the snooze button on God's call and God's plan? What are the things that cause us to hit the snooze button? You've been saying, man, I've been wanting to read through the Bible. What are the things that cause you to hit the snooze button on doing something like that? Getting up early and praying or whatever it might be. What are these things that cause you to hit the snooze button in life? Well, you know, I think there's a lot of things. I think sin is a major aspect of that. I think the very sin nature of humanity, the very fact that it's in opposition to God, that when it comes time to get up and pray, well, I'm going to hit the snooze button. When it comes time to, you know, to take a stand and be that godly example as a parent, you know, I'm going to hit that snooze button for today. I'll do that tomorrow. Today, I just want to go home and watch TV. I just want to zone out. I just want to kick back a beer or do whatever I want to do. I'll hit the snooze button later. What causes us? You know, I think sin does. I think a lot of times complacency does that. You get comfortable. You think about the bed, right? How cozy and warm it is and how comfortable it is. And you got to get out of the bed and you got to change your clothes. You got to take a shower, hopefully, in the morning or before you go to bed at some point, maybe. Just would help everybody around you. Got to brush your teeth, hopefully, maybe. Would help somebody around you. Right, you got to get up, you got to start doing something. And so complacency, that comfort level of just, I'm not ready today. Procrastination. The desire to push it off for some other time. How about the flesh? The very fact that our desires are oftentimes in opposition to what God wants for us. Well, I want to build my kingdom today, God, not your kingdom. So, you know, I'm going to hit the snooze button on building God's kingdom, and I'm going to build my kingdom today. I don't think I can do that. I don't think I can step out today. I'm gonna hit the snooze button and fulfill my desires today. You know, you've been thinking. Think about this. The Bible talks a lot about it, man. God's been dealing with me about this. How about our consumerism, our love for food, gluttony? Man, I've been thinking about going on that diet. I've been thinking about taking a step back. Thinking about taking an idea of my health and my ideas. And God says, why you keep hitting the snooze button? I created you. Your body is a living temple. Why are you going to stop hitting the snooze button and start taking care of yourself? You see, there are all sorts of things in our lives that we hit the snooze button for. And the whole idea is that I have a little bit more time. It buys me time. I've got some more time. But the truth of the matter is we don't know what the time holds for us. We don't know what tomorrow is. I love that old proverb from, what is it, that really wise proverb? It's from Kung Fu Panda, right? Yesterday is the past, the future is unknown, that's why today is the present, right? See, we don't understand what tomorrow holds. We don't even know if we have that. And hit the snooze button's like trying to buy more time. I'll do it tomorrow. I'll do it the next day. I'll do it the next week. I'll do it the next month. I'll do it the next year. I'll do it when I retire. I'll do it when I graduate. I'll do it during summer break. I'll do it after work. When God says, how about you just do it right now? Because he says, know the time. The time is you don't have tomorrow. Tomorrow, yesterday's already gone. Knowing the time today, right now, right here, the very present time of your life is the only time you have control of. And he says, know the time. He says, stop hitting the snooze button of your life. He says, wake up, get out of bed, throw away the old ways, the sin nature, stop living in revelries and drunkenness, stop living in strife and in envy. And he says, put on the person of Jesus Christ in your life so that you would be and that you would do and that you would act according to how I've called and how I've purposed and how I've designed for you to live. There are far too many people in this world. There are far too many people in this nation that are sleepwalking through life, hitting the snooze button every day. Listen, church, all you got to do is go into a public place, stop for a moment and look around. 85% of the people that you talk about, every 85% of the people that you look at in a public place standing around, what are they doing? Snoozing. Why go out when I can read about somebody else's Facebook about the going out? Why step out in life when somebody said that, you know, that wasn't worth doing? On social media. Why do anything? Why? Because now I've got everything at my fingertips, so I don't need to experience it for myself. And you see, that's the very idea of sleeping in. That's the very idea. I don't need that. I can do that later. But you see, if the devil can get you to sleep in your life, you will miss your time. All right, I'm preaching better than your amen, but that's okay. I don't need your amens. I don't need them. I remember there was a time, talking about sleeping and physically sleeping. I remember there was a time I was running the video department. It was a really important service. And I was sleeping in, man. My bed was comfortable. I had that little, you know, those egg crate foam things? Oh, those are just amazing. I had one of those on my bed. It was when I was living at my mom and dad's house before I was married, running the video department. And all of a sudden, my dad, Pastor Jim, now you know Pastor Jim, he's 6'5", big guy, right? I mean, just my dad comes in and he's all ready for church. It's a Sunday morning. And he comes in, tie and everything, and he's like, hey, church starts in 20 minutes. I'm leaving. I hope you're going to make it there in time. And I'm like, oh, to wake up, right? I had been hitting the snooze button for 2 hours, never woke up. Finally, my parents to teach me a lesson. Praise the Lord for parents that love you enough to teach you a lesson. Waited until they were leaving to go to church to tell me that I had slept in. They didn't wake me up. They said, no, you got to learn. So what happened? I got dressed as fast as humanly possible. I don't think it was a miracle of God. It was like teleportation. It was like all of a sudden, boom, I'm at church. Like, thank you, Jesus. Like Stephen caught up in the, or Philip caught up in the book of Acts. Like, here I am. But you see, when you sleep in, you're missing out on what's happening in that moment. And just like that time I slept in and I literally missed like the first 10 minutes of church, and that was my job to like do praise and worship and video and all that stuff. I came into the control room and everybody was hovering around all the equipment like, how do we turn it on? I'm like, get out there, get out there. If the devil can get you to sleep in your life, if the devil can get you to hit snooze on God's call for your life, if the devil can get you to stop, if your flesh can convince you to not get out of bed in the morning, guess what? You're going to miss your time. You're going to miss what God has. Why? Because Paul said to the church, knowing the time, it's high time, not tomorrow, not yesterday, it's high time today. You see, we've got this moment in our lives. So we got to understand, we can't afford to miss out on this and listening to the influence of our flesh, listening to the influence of the spirits of the devil and the cultures of the world to sleep in will get you to miss out on your life. And guess what you're doing? You're making his job a whole lot easier. All right. You're like, man, I didn't think I was going to come to church and get preached at. Praise God. Go with me. Go with me to the book of Matthew in the 25th chapter. I want to show you a little bit about sleeping in, missing your time. Matthew, the 25th chapter. We're going to read a couple verses here. I'm going to tell you a story. Well, I'm going to tell you a story that Jesus told a story of. Matthew, the 25th chapter, Jesus is talking about the parable of 10 virgins. It's an illustration. It's an allegory of not knowing the time, of making the best of it and being ready at a moment's notice, being prepared, not being slothful and lazy. And Jesus gives this illustration of 10 virgins. Let's read it in verse number 1 of chapter 25. So Jesus says that the kingdom of heaven shall be likened to 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were wise, 5 were foolish. Of those who were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. But while the bridegroom was delayed, they all slumbered and slept. A couple things here. It's a little convenient, it's a little comforting to know that no wedding ever has started on time. And that's not just a 21st century American thing. Jesus, 2,000 years ago, the bridegroom was delayed. You've been to a wedding waiting for hours for the bride. Now, usually it's the bride you're waiting on, but there's times where it's the bridegroom or it's the groom. But look what he says. He says, they all slept. Everybody fell asleep. They were waiting. Everybody was sleeping. Everybody was slumbering. That's all right. There's a time for that. And then he says this and says, verse number 6, and at midnight a cry was heard. Behold, the bridegroom is coming. Go out to meet him. Then all those virgins arose and they trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said to the wise, give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out. But the wise answered, saying, no, lest there should not be enough for all of us, you and you. So go and sell, go to those who sell and buy for yourselves. And listen to this. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came. And those who were ready went in with him, and the door was shut. You see, you'll allow the devil to convince you to sleep in, you'll miss your time. Jesus says, if you're living life on the snooze button, procrastinating, waiting till the last minute, they waited till the last minute to buy their oil. They didn't come prepared. They didn't wake up. They weren't ready for what God had for them. And when it came time, they were not prepared. They were hitting the snooze button on their life. And so what did they have to do? They had to make up for it and go out and buy oil. And they missed their time. So the door was shut. So what happens at the end of the story? Well, at the end of the story, Jesus says, and they come back and they start banging on the door. They say, let us in. And the bridegroom responds and he says, surely I don't know you. You didn't come. You didn't welcome me. Who are you? And Jesus gives us this challenge. Jesus gives this warning. Jesus gives this direction to his church. And he says, watch, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour in which the Son of Man is coming. You see, church, we don't have the opportunity in our lives to hit the snooze button and say, I got a little bit more time. Because you don't know what tomorrow holds. I don't know what the next week, the next month, the next year, the next 10 minutes of my life hold. You see, I can't afford to take what God has given to me, this life that is so valuable, that God says, I've done something, I've created something on the inside of you to bring a change to your family, to bring a change to your job, to bring a change to your school, to bring a change to those who are around you. I haven't called you, I haven't given to you my Son and my Spirit to live on the inside of you, that you can hit the snooze button and wait for another day that you don't know is going to come. Jesus says, listen, it's time for you to wake up and to open your eyes and watch, because you don't know what tomorrow holds. Today is the only time you've got, and we got to stop hitting the snooze button of our life trying to buy a little bit more time. God says, I want you to use it now. Use it now. So what do? I just, so simple, so easy. Keep your, and I put in parentheses because I know I'm using the analogy of sleeping in for real, but keep your spiritual eyes open. You see, at the end of that scripture, Jesus said, watch. He said, you got to pay attention. As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us throughout the Bible, there's so many scriptures that confirm the Word of God that says, you watch, keep open, keep vigilant, keep your eyes open, be sober. Why? Because you don't know what's coming around the corner. You don't know what the devil has for you. You don't know what tomorrow holds, but you gotta stay alert and be attentive. Why? So that you could fulfill God's plan for your life, and you can do what God has done, or you could do what God has planned for you to do. Keep your spiritual eyes open. What happens when you sleep? Think about it. I mean, have you ever been so tired? Let's think about this in the physical. Have you ever been so tired that you just couldn't keep your eyes open any longer? Well, you know, you start doing, you're sitting there, maybe you're watching a show or a movie with somebody, you're sitting on the couch, or you're sitting in the passenger seat. It's always in the passenger seat, right? You're not driving. Somebody else is driving. And all of a sudden, it's like, oh, you just start feeling it coming on. What do? You start like closing one eye at a time, right? You're like, oh, just give this one a little bit of a break, right? And then you do the other one. And then, hey, are you sleeping? No, I'm not sleeping. Just let my eyes rest, right? We've all been there. We've all said that. And then what happens, right? You know what happens, right? Your head starts to droop. Sorry, go like this, right? And then you catch yourself, and everybody's laughing at you, but nobody will admit that they're laughing at you. It's like the funnest thing to watch in church. Don't think I can't see you. You're like, Pastor Luke, I sit in the back. I'm like, I can see you. Especially when your mouth's all open and you're drooling. And all of a sudden, what happens, right? Your head nods, and you come up. Yeah, amen. Right? Yeah, that's right. But think about that. Think about it for a moment. You fall asleep in the passenger seat of a car. You fall asleep, heaven forbid, in a comfortable chair in church. What happens? You start to lose attention, right? You start to lose focus. You're not even aware of the surroundings about you. I remember there was one time, there was a guy in our youth group, a crazy guy, redheaded dude. Just, I mean, any opportunity this guy had to mess with you, he messed with you. And so I was out there in the youth group, and we were out there driving, and he was driving. I think we went and saw a movie after church one time, so it was really late at night. And there we are driving. I'm sitting in the passenger seat. Sure enough, as we're driving home, I do the whole nod off thing, right? And he's like, you all right? I'm like, oh, I'm cool. I got it. I got it together. Sure enough, all of a sudden, I don't know what happened. I was gone. What does he do? He takes the opportunity, and I've seen people in our church do this, right? He takes the opportunity. He slams on the brakes as hard as he can, and he screams at the top of his lungs, oh my God! Sure enough, like the people that fall asleep in church that wake up, start clapping, I woke up like, oh my God! It totally got me. And ever since that moment, it was like a God encounter, because ever since that moment, I said, I'm going to commit to do that to any person that falls asleep in the front seat of my car while I'm driving. It was just an epiphany from the Lord. But you see, you lose your awareness. You're not thinking about what's going on. You're distracted from what needs to get done, right? When you're sleeping, you're asleep. And when you're sleeping, and you ever had somebody just try to get them up, like you're, you know, maybe you're like, I got a teenager. Praise God for this right now, right? You're like, get up, I'm awake. No, you're not, right? Come back in, get up, I'm up. No, you're not. You see, you lose that situational awareness, and God says, listen, man, you don't know what the time is. You don't know what's coming up your way. You don't know what's coming around the corner. You don't know what the devil has in store for you. You don't know what culture, what your society's bringing. And if you're too busy snoozing through life, look it. Oh, let me just get on my soapbox for a minute. If you're too busy raising your kids like, yep. If you're too busy living your life, whatever social media has to say, and you're hitting the snooze button on what you need to be doing, guess what you're doing? You're missing everything that's going on around you. God didn't call you to miss life. God called you to live life. That's why Jesus came, to give us life. But yet we spend our time snoozing. As a matter of fact, 1 Thessalonians, the 5th chapter, tells us like this. Paul tells the church, he says, listen, y'all got to be sober. He says, let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch and be sober. You see, you got to keep your spiritual eyes open. Why? Because sin, like God told Cain, sin lies at your door and it seeks to rule you. But God said to Cain, I have not created you that sin should rule you, but that you should rule it. But you got to keep your eyes open and stop hitting the snooze button every once in a while. My wife and I, we watched this show on Discovery Channel. I mean, like for 11 years we've watched the show. I don't know why I'm so captivated by it, but it's called Deadliest Catch, and it's these guys, they go to Alaska and they catch crab. And every year, you know what they do? Every year they go to Alaska and they catch crab. And then like the next season comes up, right? And then they go up to Alaska and they catch crab again. And then like the year after that, they go up to Alaska and I don't know how they've been running that show for that long, but every year we're like, oh, it's on, it's time. And through my 11 years of watching Deadliest Catch, I kind of consider myself to be somewhat of a Bering Sea crabbing expert. I know my thing. I know my lingo. You know the cardinal rule? I mean, the greatest sin you can commit on the Bering Sea is to fall asleep at the watch. Because you're talking about the roughest sea on earth. The biggest waves. These guys are fishing in the middle of hurricane winds and 50-foot swells. And there's a crew of people whose lives are at stake. And the captain or whoever's watching the boat, whoever's behind the wheel, their one job is to make sure that boat doesn't capsize, that boat doesn't hit an obstacle, that boat doesn't run over one of the crab pots and get the line stuck in the propeller that would immobilize it in a storm. But yet, it's like every season, the one guy gets the job, and after the long shift, he's tired, he's distracted, his eyes are heavy. And what does he start doing? He starts nodding off, and they got the camera. It's like, the crew is watching you, dude. You know this is going to go on TV. And they start nodding off, and they start nodding off, and then something happens. A big wave comes, and the alarm goes off, and the guy's still asleep. He's just over there, hunched over, and there's the captain sitting there in the pilot house of the boat watching them. And all of a sudden, boom. They wake up and they've been caught and they get fired and their whole life is completely changed. Why? Because of that one moment of falling asleep. You see, sin is so subtle in our lives that if we don't keep a watch over it, if we don't keep our spiritual eyes open and in tune to the world around us, the devil is going to do everything he can in your life through the sin nature of your flesh, through the cultures of this world, to get you to hit the snooze button. Why? So that you make his job easier. And so we got to be vigilant. We can't fall asleep at the wheel. As a matter of fact, Jesus tells a story just like this in Mark the 13th chapter. Verse number 34, I'll read it to you out of the New Living Translation. Jesus tells a similar story. Jesus says it like this. He says, listen, no one knows the days or the hour when these things will happen, talking about the Son of God returning. Not even the angels in heaven or the Son himself. Only the Father knows. He says, listen to this. He says, and since you don't know when that time will come, listen to this, be alert, be on guard, he says. Keep your eyes open. The coming of the Son of Man will be illustrated by the story of a man who goes on a long trip. When he left his home, he told his slaves and gave them instructions about the work that they should do, and he told the gatekeeper to what? Watch for his return.
You too, Jesus says, must watch for his return. For you don't know when the master of the household will return. In the evening, at midnight, before dawn, or at daybreak. Don't let him, listen, look at what Jesus says. Don't let him find you sleeping when he arrives without warning. Don't let him find you sleeping when he arrives. Listen, God's been speaking to you about what you got to do. It's that relationship in your life. You say, man, I feel like my things have been going on. We've drifted apart. Don't let God catch you sleeping on the job saying, I gave you that woman. I gave you that man. What did you do with that? Don't let God catch you sleeping on the job as a parent. I gave you that child. That's a gift of God to you. What were you doing with your time? Don't let God catch you sleeping on your job, slacking off. God says, I gave you that place of provision so that you could be a light to the workplace, so that you could show what it is to be a representative of Jesus Christ. And look at what you're doing. Don't let God catch you sleeping through life. Why? Because God created you to live life. To live life in the light of Jesus Christ. To not live in the darkness of the world, but to live in the light of Jesus Christ. And God says, don't hit the snooze button of your life. Keep your eyes open, church. Watch. Pray. Seek after God. The disciples, when they went to the Garden of Gethsemane with Jesus, they couldn't even stay awake. Jesus came back and said, you guys can't even stay awake for an hour to pray? See, we let complacency, we let comfort, we let our nature, we let influences around us dictate to us how we live our life and hit the snooze button and sleep in a little bit longer. Say, I'll buy some more time. Jesus, I'll pray the next hour. And what does Jesus do? He goes and prays again. He comes back another hour later. You guys couldn't sleep again, or you couldn't stay awake again? What are they? Oh, I'm sorry, Jesus, we're going to do it again. What do? They hit the snooze button again. Jesus comes back a third time. The hour is at hand. And there Judas comes with the guards. You see, they missed their time. They missed their moment. God says, I don't want you to miss your moment. I don't want you to miss your purpose. I don't want you to miss that opportunity that I've set in front of you because you want to buy a little bit more time of complacency, a little bit more time of comfort. Stop hitting the snooze button. Unplug the alarm clock and get up. Wake up. Do something about that. God created you to do something with your life. Don't let your guard down to sin in your life. Because like Jesus, or like God said to Cain, it knocks at your door. It lies at your door waiting for you. But when you are sober, when you're vigilant, like Paul says in Romans, well, look at that. Look at that second half, Romans the 13th chapter again. Romans the 13th chapter, Paul says, walk properly. Look at, as in the day, awake, high time. The sun is high in the sky. You're not tripping over obstacles in the middle of the night. You're not like a parent stepping on Legos or whatever else you're stepping on in the middle of the night, stubbing your toe. He says, walk as in the day with clarity. You're awake, you're attentive, not in revelry and drunkenness and lewdness and lust or in strife or in envy. Go on, verse number 14. But look at, put on the Lord Jesus Christ. What do? You get up in the morning, you put on your clothes. You put on that shirt, you put on the pants, you put on your shoes, you put on your socks. You walk out into the real world. Paul says, look, at get up. It's time. It's time to start doing what God's been speaking to. It's time to start being that person that God's been telling you need to be. And how do you do it? You start putting on Jesus Christ in the morning. Get up. Wake up, open your eyes. God, keep my eyes open. I love how Elisha prayed. He said, Lord, I pray that you would open up my servant's eyes. And all of a sudden, his eyes were open and he saw the armies of the living God surrounding them. See, pray, God, I pray that you'd open my eyes. I don't want to sleepwalk through my life anymore. Jesus came to give me life. And Lord, I want to live in that life. Challenge yourself. Get up. Have the diligence. Wake up. Stop hitting the snooze button. Get a little bit of discipline in your life. Don't be like Pastor Luke at 3 o'clock in the morning, hitting the snooze button till 4 o'clock in the morning, hitting the snooze button till 4:30 in the morning, hitting the snooze button till 5, till 5:30, till 6, till 6:30, till 7, till 7:30, till 8. God says, get up. When I speak, get up. Keep your eyes open. Don't let sin Don't let your guard down to sin. Why? Because Jesus Christ came to give you life. We've slept through life long enough. We slept through life in our sin. We slept through life in our ignorance. We slept through life in our discontentment. We slept through life long enough. Now it's time to get up, church, to wake up and to get at it. To get at it. Why? Because there's a world out there that needs Jesus Christ. Because there's a family out there that needs a dad. There's a mom, there's a husband out there that needs a wife. There's an employer out there that needs a hard-working employee. There's somebody out there that needs what God has given you to fulfill their needs. But if we sleepwalk, if we hit the snooze button in our lives, if we say, I'll wait till tomorrow, I'll wait till next year, I'll wait till next month, I'll wait till I retire, I'll wait till I'm finished, I'll wait till school's out, I'll wait till I have the money to do it, all we're doing is we're hitting that snooze button. Hitting that snooze button. And life is passing us by, minute by minute, hour by hour, week by week, month by month. And like Jesus says, look, you don't know what tomorrow holds. So don't let it pass you by. Church, look up and engage somebody around you. Look up and participate in your family. Look up. And be who Jesus has called you to be. Be who Jesus died on a cross for you to be. Because God doesn't want us to sleepwalk through life. We've slept long enough. Paul says the time is now. It's high time to get up, to walk, not with uncertainty, but to walk in the daylight. Why? To put on Christ and the righteousness of Christ. Why? That we would not fulfill the lusts of the flesh in our life any longer. That we would be representatives of Jesus Christ. And that we would be exactly who and what God has called and destined us to be for this world. That we could be the living, walking examples of Jesus Christ to a lost and dying world that needs to know the story and the love of Jesus to this world. And it's not going to come. It's not going to come because we're sleepwalking, and it's not going to come because somebody else is going to do it for us. God said, I sent you. I sent you to your family. I sent you to your school. I sent you to your job. I sent you to your friends. I sent you to your world. But you got to wake up to go. And there are so many things in life that want to pull us away. And if we give in to it, we'll miss our time. Let's pray together. Father, we come before you. It's a challenge, Lord. I know you've been speaking to me, Lord, because there's a lot of things in my life that I've been wasting my time on. Focusing my efforts, focusing my energy on things that don't bring any fruit to the kingdom of God. And Lord, I pray that you would speak to each and every one of us as we walk out of this place today. God, that we would wake up. Lord, that we would open up our eyes and see the world around us. Lord, that we would open up our eyes and see what you have called for us. Lord, that we would open up our eyes and see the life that Jesus Christ has for each and every one of us. Lord, as we walk out of this place, I pray that we open our eyes, Lord, as we ask, Lord, that you would reveal, Lord, as we ask, Lord, I pray that you would seek, Lord, as we seek after, Lord, I pray that you would draw near to us, Lord, that we would engage in a relationship with Jesus Christ more than we have ever engaged, Lord, that we would learn to put on Jesus, and Lord, that we would take off who we once were, and Lord, we would be who you have called us to be, new creations in your Spirit and in your Son. Lord, as we walk out of this place, that we would be awake and we would be attentive to the plans of Jesus Christ. And Lord, that we would be wise to the devices of the enemy in this world that would try to ensnare us. And Lord, that we would set those aside. Lord, that we would leave those behind and we would run the race that you have set before us, the way that you have designed for us to run that race. God, that we might bring a change to our life, that we might bring a change to our relationships, that we might bring that change to our families and to our friends and to our workplaces and to our schools, not because of our own good actions, but Lord, because of Jesus who is on the inside of us, the change agent on the inside of us. And Lord, we thank you. Holy Spirit, I ask for your ministering to us as we examine our hearts. Teach us to put on Jesus and to leave the old behind and stop hitting that button of our life. Step out of our comfort zone in faith. And do something for the kingdom of God in Jesus' name. Amen? Amen. Amen. Hey, listen, before we leave tonight, I want to just take a quick moment and just ask you to do me a favor. Give me a moment more of your attention. I'll let you out in just a couple of minutes. I want to ask you a question. You see, the Bible says that you ought to examine yourself from time to time. Bible says, let each man examine his own work. It's not about what somebody else is doing. So I want to ask you a question. Nobody's going to know the answer except you and God. Don't let that distract you. They'll fix that. Nobody's going to know the answer except you and God. Here's the question I want to ask you. The question is this. If you were to leave tonight and you were to die, heaven forbid that be the case, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? You see, it's a really simple question, but nobody's going to know the answer except you and God, not your spouse, not your confidant, not your therapist, you and God and you and God alone. And how you arrive at that conclusion, how you arrive at that answer has a lot to say about your position and your place with God. You know, so often I hear when people talk to me, they say, Pastor Luke, you know, I think I'm going to go to heaven. I hope I'm going to go to heaven. I really want to get to heaven. Can I tell you something? Nowhere in God's word does it say that you can think. Nowhere does it say that you can hope. Nowhere does it say that you can want or desire. That you can have the most positive outlook on life. That you can read the most self-help books than anybody else. And you can get to heaven. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that positive outlook on life, that positive thinking is going to get you into heaven. A hope or a wish or a want. You can't get to heaven because you hope so. You can't get to heaven because you want to. You can't get to heaven because you desire to. Well, but you know, Pastor Luca, I've always thought in my life that, you know, my parents told me growing up that I was a Christian. I was raised in church. I was confirmed as a child. I was baptized or christened as a baby. When the census came knocking on my door, I labeled Christian. You know, I go to church every once in a while, and I always thought that people who go to church, you know, I've got a cross around my neck or a crucifix on my wall, and I've even got tattoos on my body that have a reference to God. Did you know nowhere in the Bible does it say that because your parents told you growing up that you were a Christian, that means you're going to get into heaven? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you attend church on a regular basis, that means that you're going to get into heaven? Nowhere does it say that because you've given yourself a label, that means that you're going to get into heaven. Listen, Jesus said it like this, you're going to come. He says people are going to come at the end of the world. They're going to say, God, didn't we cast out demons in your name? And he's going to say, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I don't know you. Why? Because it's not about a label. It's not about a title. It's not about a GPS location of your seat on a Wednesday night or a Sunday morning. God's after so much more than just your church attendance. God's after more than a cross around your neck. He's after more than a label that you give in yourself. Man, we love to label ourselves in America. Gosh, we love our labels. To identify us with. God says it's not about your label. It's not about your name. There's more to it than that. Well, but Pastor Luke, you know, I'm a good person. I try to do good things. I try to do more in my life to help people than I do bad. I've given to charitable organizations. I want to do the best I can to save the environment and things like that. And good people go to heaven. Did you know that nowhere in the Word of God, nowhere in God's Word does it say that good people get to heaven? As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us it like this, that your good deeds, according to God's righteousness, are like filthy rags. You see, nothing you could do on your own would ever make you good enough to get into heaven. You see, you can't earn it. You can't buy it. You can't work for it. You don't deserve it. The only thing you can do is accept it. Why? Because the Bible says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. See, when you were born, nobody had to teach you how to lie. Nobody had to teach you how to cheat on that test. Nobody had to teach you how to steal that thing that you wanted. That just kind of came natural to you. Why? Because there's an inherent evil born into humanity because of the sin nature on the inside of us. But you see, that's not our eternal position. Why? Because in that same scripture says, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But the gift of God, God says, is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. See, God's got a plan for you. God's got a destiny for you. And that's eternal life through Jesus Christ. Well, you know, Pastor Luke, I appreciate that. And I'm glad, you know, I have a heightened sense of spiritual awareness. I believe that, you know, it's all the same. Everybody's got different titles around the world. You know, 98.9% of the world believes in some form of higher power and higher being. So, you know, it's just, you do your thing, I'll do my thing. We'll all kind of get there the same. And you know, we'll all arrive at the same destination. Did you know the Bible tells us that all roads don't lead to heaven? As a matter of fact, Jesus says these words. He says, he is the way, the truth, and the life. He says, no one goes to the Father except through him. Listen, it's not some philosophical thought. It's not some religious idea. It's not some heightened sense of spirituality that's going to get you into heaven. The only thing that's going to get you right with God is Jesus. Why? Because Jesus is the only one who came and died for our sins. The perfect, spotless Lamb of God died on a cross 2,000 years ago. Why? So that he could offer salvation to humanity. Jesus said these words to Nicodemus, a man in John the 3rd chapter. You can read it for yourself in John chapter 3. Jesus says these words. He says, Nicodemus, in order to see the kingdom of God, he says, you must be born again. What does born again mean? Well, you think of born again, you think of what Hollywood and movies have made it out to be, sitcoms, right? Weirdo, crazy, out of control Christianity. But can I tell you something? From the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It's always meant the same thing to God's heart and God's eyes. Born again means this. It means that you've given all of your heart, you've given all of your life to God the Father through His Son, Jesus Christ. You see, it's an all or nothing relationship with God. Let me prove it to you. In the Bible, Jesus is speaking to the church. He's speaking to the church, people like you and me, sitting in the church service, doing good, praising God, doing all sorts of good things. And Jesus says these words. He says, "Behold, I'm coming back." He says, "When I come back, I'd rather find that you're hot." He says, "I'd rather find that you're cold." Why? Because He says, "If I find that you're lukewarm," He says, "I will vomit you from my mouth." I mean, it's a shocking statement out of the mouth of Jesus. You see, what Jesus is saying is, listen, I'd rather find that you're in, you're out, you're up, you're down. You know, you're somewhere. See, what does it mean to be lukewarm? Lukewarm simply means you got occasional church attendance, doing some of your own thing, doing some of God's thing. Not wholehearted for God. You're not wholehearted against God. You know, yeah, token prayer, occasional, you know, doing your own thing instead of God's thing. Listen. I love you enough. I respect you enough to tell you the truth. You're not going to make it your way. You're not going to make it on your own. God forgive us in American churches that we've watered the message down for hundreds of years. Why? Because we've been more interested in the number of people in our chairs rather than the conditions of the hearts of those people. But listen, I love you enough, I respect you enough today, I challenge you through the Word of God in the message today, and I challenge you right now. You can't make it to heaven. You can't get right with God on your own terms. You can't get right with God because you hope so, because you've got a positive outlook on life. You can't get right with God because you're a good person. You can't get right with God because you go to church on somewhat of a regular basis. You can't be right with God because you got a cross around your neck. The only way you and I can be right with God is through Jesus Christ and through Jesus Christ alone. In that same scripture, Jesus says these words. Jesus says, you think that you're rich. You think that you're wealthy. He says, but you don't realize how naked and how destitute you really are. He says, you think you're doing everything right on your own. But He says, oh, I wish that you would come and I wish that you would buy for me gold refined. I wish that you would put on clothes like Paul talked about. I wish you would put on the clothes of righteousness that I have for you. And then in that same scripture, Jesus says these words. He says, behold, I stand at the door and I knock. He says, whoever opens that door, He says, I will come in and I will be with them and they will be with me. And we will be together. You see, I believe right now that the Spirit of God is knocking on the door of your heart, saying, look, you've been looking, you've been searching, you've been prodding, you've been trying to do it your own way for long enough, and you haven't made it, and you know it. The Spirit of God's knocking on your heart saying, will you open the door to me tonight? Will you allow me to come into your heart, to come into your life, and begin a work in you that you could never do by yourself? Salvation through Jesus Christ. See, the decision's yours and totally yours. God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He's not going to force His way or make His way in. It's your choice. Well, Pastor Luke, if God wants me, He'll choose me. He'll take me. God chose you 2,000 years ago when He sent Jesus Christ to die on a cross for you and for me, for our sin and our shame, so that we could be reunited through our belief and through our hearts with Jesus, reunited with Jesus. It starts today by accepting that gift of salvation. How do I accept that? How do I open the door to my heart? Jesus says these words. He says that if you confess Him before men, He will confess you before His Father. He goes on and He says these words. He says, if you deny Him, He will deny you. The decision's yours and wholly yours. Today I want to give you the opportunity to do it. Now let's not do it your way. Let's not do it some well-meaning church committee's way. Let's do it God's way. Here's what I'm going to do in just a moment. I'm going to count to three. When I count to three, I'm going to go like this. I'm going to go one, two, and on the count of three, I'm going to go three. And I'll smack my hands together real loud, just like that. And when I smack my hands again, I'm going to ask you to do something real bold. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. You see, what you're doing by the raising of your hand, you're saying, you know what, Pastor Luke, what you're talking about? That's talking to me. I feel like I've been doing things my own way. I feel like I've been running from God. I feel like I've been kind of riding the fence. I feel like I need to give my heart. I need to give my life to Jesus. I feel God's calling me right now, and I want to respond. You see, I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. Wow, if I raise my hand, I'm going to be embarrassed. I'm not here to embarrass you. I'm here to build you. See, the decision's yours and totally yours. Who should raise their hands in this place if you've never given your heart, you've never given your life to Jesus Christ? If that's you in just a moment, when I count to three, get ready, pop your hands up. Listen, if you're not sure, maybe you did this as a child or in a youth group or at a crusade once before, but you say, I just don't really know where I stand with God. Listen, that's a gamble on your eternal life that you can't afford to make. See, the Bible tells us that the Spirit of God on the inside of us is God's seal of approval in us. God does not want you to walk through life wondering if you're going to make it. God says, I've given you my Spirit to live on the inside of you that you would know without a shadow of a doubt that you are right with me. Don't walk out of here today without making that decision. If you've been living lukewarm, what does that mean? You've been playing games, doing the church thing, doing some of God's thing, some of your own thing. You're kind of riding the fence. Listen, that's an uncomfortable place to be in. You know it. I know it. Everybody knows it. It's time for you to give your heart, to give your life over to Jesus Christ and allow Him to start doing the work that He wants to do in your life. Listen, you've been hitting the snooze button in your life long enough. Today, the alarm is going off and the invitation of the Holy Spirit is coming up to your heart right now. And the question is, are you going to respond? or you're going to hit that snooze button once again. The decision's yours and totally yours. Who should raise their hands? All across this auditorium, from the front row, the back row, side to side, wherever you're at home watching on the live stream, wherever you're at. This is your moment. This is your day. Listen, you've had doctors and dentists, DMV appointments. Tonight, it's a divine appointment. You're here because God brought you here for this reason. And it starts tonight by making that decision. In just a moment, we'll pray a prayer of salvation together. You say, I want to be included in that prayer. It's time for you to respond to the call and to the invitation of Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit in your life. Open the door to your heart. It starts by making that acknowledgement today. I'll see your hand, I'll acknowledge it, put it right back down, and we'll go forward together right after that from there. But it starts by making that decision. I'm going to count to three. If that's you in this place, it's time for you to give your heart, time for you to give your life to Jesus Christ. I'm going to count to three. If that's you, you pop your hand up, I'll see it. We'll go forward together from there. Your eternal destiny is changing right here, right now. Today is the day. I'm going to count to three. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place if that's you. One, two, three, four. I see you back there. Five, I got you. Five wise people. I see you. Six, seven. I see you right over there. Eight, I see you right over here. Eight wise people. You say, man, I wonder if I should. Yes, you should. The Spirit of God's knocking on your heart. It's time. It's time for you to respond to Jesus. If that's you in this place, come on. Now listen, I didn't embarrass them. Won't embarrass you, anybody else in this place. Eight wise people saying, it's time for me to give my heart, my life to Jesus Christ. Where are you at, number nine? Where are you at, number 10? Anybody else in this place today? God's speaking to you. Time to respond. Well, let's give the Lord a great big praise for eight people. That's great. Here's what we're going to do. In just a moment, we're all going to stand. As we stand, my friend Elijah over here, he's going to sing a song. As Elijah sings a song, if you raise your hand, and you should have raised your hand, here's what I want you to do. You said, I'm going to make that decision, making the decision to follow Jesus. You know this. This is reasoning and logic 101. No decision without action is a decision at all. Nothing will ever change unless you do something about it. So you said, I want to give my heart, I want to give my life to Jesus Christ. Now it's time to act on it. So we're going to pray a prayer of salvation together. If that's you in this place, you raise your hand, you should have raised your hand. I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend if you need a friend. I want you to get out of your seat, get out of your chair, get into the aisle and come meet me right here at this altar. We're going to change destinies together right here, right now, tonight. Your life is going to change forever. So let's all stand together. If you raised your hand or you should have raised your hand, come on, this is your moment. This is your time. Come meet me right here, right now. If that's you, come on. If you raise your hand, come on, this is your moment, this is your time. Well, listen, man, all right, you guys are coming, come on, you come. While you come, I'm going to talk to other people, it's all right. Are both you girls coming or just one of you? Both you girls coming? Both? You two? It's okay. I'm just asking. Yeah? Okay. Two. Okay, cool. I counted eight. There's six. Listen, I got to tell you. I'm in your face. I'm just not going to beat around the bush about it. Somebody's got to tell you, you're not going to get into heaven because you raised your hand in a church service. You said, I want to give my heart and life to Jesus Christ. You said, I want to do that. Now you're making the decision. Now you're not following through with the action. If you think you can't follow with that action in church, what makes you think you're going to walk outside of the walls of this building and follow Jesus? What's real? I love you enough. I respect you enough today to tell you the truth. You cannot do that. Start off your life wrong with Jesus Christ. If you said, I'm going to give my heart, I'm going to give my life to Jesus Christ, get out of your seat. Get out of your chair. Stop hitting the snooze button of your life. It's time to act now. I'm going to ask Elijah to sing that song one more time. And if that's you in this place and you raise your hand, or listen, you know you should have raised your hand. It's time for you to start changing your life by giving Jesus your heart and giving him your life. So get out of your seat, get out of your chair, get up here to the altar, and let's change destinies together. Elijah, would you sing that song one more time? If that's you, this is your moment. Come on. Jesus, I believe. Awesome, they're coming. If that's you, come on. Jesus,
Listen, you guys came. You might have made a whole life worth of bad decisions. And maybe nobody's ever told you in your life, good job, but let me be the first person to tell you, good job. Good job, you're doing a good job. You're making the right choice. I know it takes a lot to do it, but you're doing it. Here's what I want to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving? Remember I said we're going to pray a prayer of salvation. He's going to take you guys right over there. Nothing weird goes on. You're going to pray a prayer. You're going to lead Jesus. You're going to ask Jesus to come into your heart, to come into your life, right? You're going to give your heart to Jesus Christ. Second thing he's going to do is he's going to give you some free information. We want you to leave this place hooked up, all right? We don't want you to leave wondering what's going on. What am I going to do next? We're going to set you off in the right direction. The third thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you to come back. We want to get you connected with a friend here at the church, all right? Somebody that will meet with you right before church service. They'll buy a cup of coffee if you come on a Sunday morning when our cafe's open. They'll get you some French fries or something like that. Sit down with you for a couple of weeks to teach you some things about the Word of God, to get you strong in the ways of God so that you don't go back to life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in everything Jesus Christ has for you for the rest of your life. So if you guys just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with my buddy, Pastor Joel. Praise God.